Hello, welcome to Let's Talk Sports. I am Ralph LaBella.
And I'm Ron Sen. We're deep into basketball season, so there's a lot of basketball to talk about tonight. First, an issue came up this week where I raised the question on a message board on Facebook, a private coaching forum that I'm on. Do you coach rebounding or do you find rebounders? And surprisingly, there wasn't a lot of discussion, but I wanted to see what Ralph thinks before I proceeded further.
Well, to me, rebounding comes from desire. It's as simple as that. I mean, I'm seeing it every game. You know, these teams are going up against teams that are out rebounding us. And, you know, I talked to the girls about that. One game, we had to get out rebounded on the offensive boards. I said it was like 30-5. It was probably more 25-5. We got out rebounded, and it was a pretty good game. We could have won the game. You know, it was a close game the whole way. We lost it at the end. It was in the Metro West A League in Westwood, the team we beat in the finals of last year. And they just had more desire. I mean, you could see it. The girls were flying in from the wings, going in for rebounds. And you see some of my girls were just hoping the ball came to them. And they were thinking, well, let someone else get the rebound. And we're trying to get tougher on a rebound. But we get beat every game by rebounding.
Well, I have a saying, possession and possessions. Possession means you've got to get the ball, and that's rebounding. In, for example, the NBA, the good teams get over 75% of the rebounds on the defensive boards, and the stronger teams can get as high as 40% on the offensive boards. Now, I wrote to a Division I coach, who I protect her anonymity, and asked her the same question, and this is what she replied, or at least part of it. I've been on that quest for years. When we lost a title because of being out-rebounded, I was relentless researching, asking coaches, collecting drills, basically doing everything I could. I've resigned myself to the fact that it's all the component skills you mentioned. I talked about toughness, positioning, desire, good hands. We do the drills early in the year. We prioritize it. We compete. Bottom line is, does the player think it's important, and will they do the work? I haven't found the answer. And so my opinion is I don't really do a lot of rebounding coaching because I think the girls that rebound, I encourage even more to do the rebounding, and the kids who don't rebound, don't rebound.
Right. And to me, it's all about desire and understanding the game and anticipating and being locked in the game. I mean, the girls are the boys that just watch the ball go up, and if the ball comes to them, they'll try to rebound it. I mean, there's no desire there. There's no desire to get the rebound. I talked to my girls before the last game. I said, I want everybody on the defensive boards, and I want you going for the rebound. I want everybody doing everything they can to get the rebound.
Yeah, on the defensive end, I think it's about, number one, positioning, and number two, toughness, so you don't get pushed under. And on the offensive end, I think it's more aggressiveness and anticipation. You have to have a good idea. You know that certain players tend to shoot long or short. So you have to anticipate where the ball is going to come off, and I think the good players just have a knack for it. I don't really think you can teach it. Maybe you can study it on film, but fortunately we have enough players who are willing to rebound. And occasionally we'll see these kids who are really little still get rebounds because they've got such great anticipation.
Yeah, I mean, I have a couple of girls on my team that are very good rebounders. I mean, they position well, they box out, but two girls that. Doesn't work with just two girls. Everybody's got to do the job. And if you have girls that are playing a lot but don't take that seriously enough, what do you do? You're going to have maybe sit them down.
The news of the day, I guess, was David Price showing up in Florida. I mean, I'm not sure what you do if you go to spring training 9 or 10 days early before everyone else gets there. Maybe he just wanted to get warmed up instead of being in Carolina. But he's showing that he's wants to do the right thing, be a good teammate. He'll be there to greet everyone. Probably has the sticks down there, and he's playing golf in the afternoon. I don't know.
How much is he getting paid, Ron?
A lot.
I think that's what he's showing. Hey, they gave me $27 million, whatever. Is it more than
that? 30, I think.
$30 million a year. You know, I can at least go down there and show everybody, get everybody on the right page right off the bat.
I'll show up the day after the season if you give me that kind of money. But it'll be interesting to see what happens. We'll talk a little bit about the Red Sox later. Now, we have to say something about the Super Bowl. First of all, it really wasn't a very entertaining game. I don't think anything about the Super Bowl was very entertaining. I didn't think the halftime show was very entertaining. the game itself was disappointing. Carol, the only people that should really feel good about the game were the Patriots' offensive line, because they realized that they weren't as bad as everyone thought they were, because Carolina's offensive line was terrible.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about the Patriot game against Denver. I mean, our last show was that week before the game. I mean, that was a disaster. A number of things went wrong in that game. But in that game there, the Patriot game, I think the number one play, the biggest play of the game, was on the first drive that when Denver had the ball. They had third down and 10. And for some reason, I don't know if why they were playing a soft zone or whatever they were playing, they had Butler off Sanders 14 yards on third and 10. Manning sees it, completes an easy 10-yard pass for a first down. From there, they go down and they kick the field goal.
They scored a touchdown.
They scored a touchdown then.
Well, certainly throughout the postseason, Peyton Manning wins his second Super Bowl, wonderful. He couldn't throw the ball. And if Carolina had done anything, the two consecutive fumbles that Manning had late in the game, if Carolina goes down and scores after that, Manning's the GOAT, not the Super Bowl champion.
Yeah, that's how it happens. Look at the Patriots against the Giants in two of those games. You know, if Samuel holds on to that pass, you know, Manning's the GOAT. Then instead, he's the MVP.
He threw one pass during the game. I swear it went end over end. I've never seen a pass do that ever.
Well, he's got to thank God. I mean, he had that defense. Yeah, the defense did it for him. That's how they scored one touchdown, a second touchdown. They got it on another turnover.
Yeah, Ware and Von Miller were fantastic rushing the passer. I don't know what Carolina has to blame. The Patriots, they said that Stork was telegraphing the snap because just before he snapped, every time he lifted his head. So Denver just go when he lifted his head, and you know that was unfortunate. But because again, the Patriots didn't have the record that they could host the home game. So then there was the crowd noise and the silent count that
they blew it themselves.
Right, they have nobody to blame.
Blew it themselves. They drop a punt against Denver during the season. Harper drops the punt. They have complete control of the game. They blow the game against Philly.
To me, I thought the biggest play in the Super Bowl was the failure to overturn the challenge with the catch, which I didn't think the ball ever hit the ground. It was an ugly play.
Well, you know what happened? I think what happened was when the receiver ended up hitting the ground, had the ball in his hand, but the tip of the ball hit the ground. After that, he bobbled it and then controlled it again at the end. I think what the reason was is because, again, the tip of the ball hit the ground. Even though he had control of the ball, he bobbled it from there, and I believe that's the reason why.
Is that the explanation they gave?
No, but I think.
Okay. But obviously, Carolina would have had the ball about midfield, and instead they're deep in their own territory. They had the fumble that led to a touchdown.
How about the drops, too? How about the big one in the second half, right down the middle in Denver's territory, and the receiver was afraid to put his hands out?
Yeah, it wasn't a great effort. Obviously, there was the play in the fourth quarter where the fumble right in front of Newton, and Newton inexplicably, he said something about his leg was in a bad position. He was standing up. I don't know. He didn't go for it.
I wouldn't blame him for that one play. I mean, he should have went for it, but I mean, you had to think, you know, he's a competitor. You've played sports. He's getting his head batting during that game, and there's nothing going right. Every time he goes back to pass, he's under pressure. And he probably, mentally, he was starting to lose it. He was losing the edge. And in that situation there, he probably had it.
Well, certainly in the Patriots game, Brady was, you know,
Brady went 16 for 32 in the second half with 220-something yards, didn't he?
I don't know the
exact numbers. He led them on three drives that they just didn't finish.
Right.
Well, they had the one touchdown at the end.
Well, I didn't have a problem with about 6 minutes to go when they went for the first down on fourth and one. I didn't have a problem with that because I didn't think they'd get the ball down in scoring position.
Here was my thinking, though. I didn't know which way they should do. But my thinking was, and the funny thing is, I'm watching my daughter, and my daughter said they should kick the field goal right off the bat. She goes, they should kick the field goal because they got to still score a touchdown and 2 points if they score the touchdown. If they don't get the 2 points, they're still going to be behind. They're going to need another score. They kick the field goal, get the ball back, score a touchdown, they don't have to worry about the 2 points. And, you know, when you think about it, you know, and this is later on, I'm thinking, but my daughter was telling me right there, he should kick the field goal. They don't have to worry about the 2 points. They get a touchdown, they win the game. The way the defense was playing, you knew they were going to get the ball back. So, I mean, when you look at it that way, you're saying, yeah, because who was confident in them getting the 2 points? Mm-hmm. When, you know, not many people were confident they were going to get the 2 points the way they were going. But you get the momentum, you know you need a touchdown to win the game. You're in four down situation at that time with maybe 3 or 4 minutes to go. You know, chances are.
I thought there was one play that was interesting in the Super Bowl that nobody commented on. Gano missed the field goal and hit the top of the goalpost. Now, that was the 5-foot extension that got put on the goalpost because Belichick wanted the rule change. So if they don't have that extension, it's a tough call. Do they call it? I mean, I think they would have called it no good because I do believe there's kind of a conspiracy theory that the NFL wanted Denver to win the Super Bowl.
But yeah, it wasn't a sure thing if the Pats had beaten Denver they would have beat Carolina.
No.
Because they wouldn't have been rushing them. I mean, they would have been coming up the middle with Hightower and Collins more. But around the edges, they wouldn't have got to him around the edges like Denver was. So, you know, he would have more time to throw. Don't forget, the first drive, he overthrows the receiver.
Well, the other thing is, to me, if a Patriot player did what Tlaib did, grabbed the guy's face mask down there and just twisted it and threw the guy out of bounds, I would have expected him to get thrown out of the game.
And the idiot said, I did it on purpose. Now he's going to get suspended. When that came out, he said, I did it on purpose because I knew he was down at the 3-yard line. It was only going to be half the distance. So, you know, now they're saying he's going to end up getting suspended for probably 2 games starting next year. If he kept his mouth shut, you know, no suspension, it just happened, you know, in that situation. But that was vicious.
Right.
That was
vicious.
I mean,
the guy could break his neck on that kind of play. Well, anyway. One thing that's interesting is to see how teams rise and fall in college basketball. And Duke's men's team has been in the top 25 literally for years, and then they dropped out only to win 3 games in a row and get back into the top 25. I checked, they were in number 21 in the RPI. There was a kind of an interesting article about Grayson Allen, who was a freshman last year, made a couple of very big plays in the championship game, and he's sort of become the new Leitner, the player that people like to hate on Duke.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's like as a person. It's more of just what he represents, I guess.
Yeah, he's a hard-nosed player. They have like 7 freshmen on that team. And now the point guard, I forget his name, is starting to play more.
Ulis?
Yeah, he's young.
No,
But they have talent. But again, they're not big and tough down low. I mean, they're athletic down low. You know, and that may hurt them. But they look good against Louisville. That's a shame what happened in Louisville.
Well, Louisville, for people who don't know, took a self-imposed suspension where they won't go to the postseason this year for their recruiting violations, which were, I don't know if they actually confessed to them, they just said improprieties.
No, they said there was. Yeah, there was, yeah.
And now, who gets punished? Does Pitino get punished? No, it's just the players. So.
Well, the 2 transfers in, they came to Louisville to play in the tournament, and I think this is their last year. They have 50th seniors, and they're not going to be able to play, and they're handling them properly. That's what Pitino said.
The tournament's pretty wide open because every team's lost 3 or 4 games.
Yeah.
So I don't think that
Villanova, you know, number one now.
Last I saw, I think was Oregon and then
Villanova recently.
Oklahoma, Providence is really good. Providence got a kid, Chris Dunn, who I think he'd be pretty good for the Celtics.
They lost a big game recently.
Yeah.
But I think Villanova is now number one, but. You know, I mean, the team in basketball, you know what the team in basketball
well,
is.
Well, obviously, UConn beat the South Carolina women was it 11?
Yeah, it was by 12, 66-54. They were up by 21. They cruised at the end. But, I mean, South Carolina undefeated, 18,000 fans at South Carolina. Great program now. UConn goes in there. The place is going nuts, and they dominated them right from the beginning. Stewart was just unreal. She was unreal. She had like 5 blocks, 10 rebounds, 25 points. Just dominated Wilson down low.
Is Burke playing yet?
She's not playing much. She's not Butler.
Oh, Butler, sorry,
6'5".
Yeah.
You know, they got Tuck, who's playing unbelievable. Morgan Tuck, who I hope comes back next year. She'll be, she's a redshirt junior this year. I hope she comes back next year because they're going to need some help when Stewart goes, but Butler should fill in there, and Samuelson, the freshman, is going to be a star next year.
The play of the day, yesterday in college basketball was Boise State at Colorado State. It's a tie game with 0.7 left. Boise State throws it in down the sideline. A kid throws it in and goes in off the backboard. Clearly the ball's in the air before the backboard lights up. So they run off the court. They've won the game on the road. And then there's this big, the referees get together. There's an argument about whether the clock started on time.
Oh.
So they wave it off. They wave it off even though clearly the replay shows the basket's good.
Did they go to the monitor?
Yeah, they went to the monitor.
Well, maybe they went to see if the clock started when the ball was thrown in.
Well, they used a stopwatch. I don't know how you use a stopwatch for 7/10 of a second.
7/10 of a second when they threw it in?
Yeah. So the guy just caught it and threw it. So anyway.
Did you see it?
Yeah, I saw the highlights. So all I was going by was the ball is in the air before the basket's on. Anyway, so that Boise State really needed to win. They're on the margin for getting into the tournament, so they lose in double overtime. So that the star player on Boise State writes on Twitter, said, "It's pretty bad when the other team says the referees cheated you out of the game." Anyway. It's really remarkable kind of stuff. We'll talk a lot more about the Celtics going forward because the Celtics have had a couple of really quality wins lately. We'll just talk a little bit about last night's game, overtime win against Doc Rivers and the Clippers.
Yeah, that was a great game. A couple tough calls in that game, too, when they had thankfully they missed both foul shots on that terrible call at the end. Was it regulation?
Yeah.
Whenever it was towards the end of the game. But, I mean, they played great. The guy that I was down on, Turner, has been playing tremendous lately.
Yeah, he's been very, very good down the stretch. I think as far as taking the ball to the basket and finishing from the opposite side of the basket with his right hand, I don't think I've ever seen anybody who can do that
Turner?
Better. Yeah.
How about Isaiah, huh?
Well.
What shots he made yesterday?
He made a step back. 12-footer maybe with 5.6 seconds on the unbelievable shot over DeAndre Jordan. And, the guy's probably 5'8".
But you know what it is, Ron? It shows you give someone a chance. There were three-point guards on Sacramento when he was there. You know, was it Sacramento or Phoenix? Well, whatever.
Phoenix, I think.
But then he was with Sacramento one time. But he didn't get a chance to play much. Now he's the star of the Celtics. He's running the show. He's getting better and better. I was a little down on him early in the year. He wasn't getting enough assists. He's starting to get more assists now, getting more people involved. But when they need a basket, I mean, he can penetrate, pull up for the jump shot, you know, and Turner's been playing really good. But we're going to talk more about that.
Yeah, we'll be right back to give you more talk about the Celtics. Welcome back. As excited as we are about the Celtics, we have no idea who's going to be on the team after the All-Star break because Danny Ainge is rumored to be very aggressively marketing players, and there's a few big people out there. Al Horford from the Hawks, number one. Probably not DeMarcus Cousins. I don't think they're going to be able to trade for him. But the Celtics have lots of assets. They have three first-round draft choices likely this year, including the right now it's the number three pick. So they have assets to move. And they certainly need another big guy.
Yeah, I mean, I think if they can make that big trade for Cousins, I would look for Horford. I mean, Atlanta, they say, I don't know why, but they say Atlanta wants to break up their team. And they're talking Horford, Teague, and a couple of other players. And my feeling is, even though I really love Olenek, I don't think he's ever going to be the player he should be on the Celtics. There's just too many people involved in that offense. And he's not going to be involved. And, you know, two games he'll get the ball, he'll get his shots. The next game he won't see the ball much. But to me, he's very good at setting a pick and rolling and popping and defending a pick. Very good shooter. He can take the ball to the hoop. He's got to get more touches. Maybe with Atlanta, if they trade Horford and Teague to the Celtics, I would love to see that deal. And I even though I love Olenek goes with Bradley and the Dallas pick and their pick, two number one picks, not the Brooklyn pick, I would make that deal.
Well, I'm agreeing with you. I think Bradley, He's not as good defensively as people, as he used to be, because he spends more time offensively. He's averaging 15 points a game, but you can get guys to score 15 points a game. So I'm not really sure that I don't think he's ever going to be a 20-point-a-game guy.
Well, you know, yeah, I know what he is, though, Ron. Like, he'd be good. He's good with Isaiah, playing with Isaiah, because Isaiah handles the ball. Thomas can't handle the ball. He's terrible handling the ball. Isaiah can get him the ball for the pull-up jump shots, cutting to the basket. That's the best part of Thomas's game.
And Bradley. Oh.
Yeah, I mean Bradley, excuse me. But, you know, you look at this, he's a terrible passer, and his basketball mentality is very weak. He's not
smart.
Well,
look at it. He fouls the guy with one inside 1 second. Make the guy take an outside shot and win the game. Don't put him on the free throw line.
He's done that a number of times this year.
I know. He
fouls at the end because he's too aggressive.
He did it yesterday. He fouled Redick.
Twice.
Yeah, he fouled Redick twice. I mean, you can't foul jump shots. You just can't foul jump shots. And he has to know that by now.
Yeah, and if the Celtics are going to get to where they want to get to, your basketball IQ has got to be. I mean, look at Bird's teams. They were smart. They were as smart as the Lakers with Magic. And you look at this team when they had Garnett and Allen and Pierce, smart team, even talented team, but you need to play with your head.
Yeah, you see guys who are solid players who also know how to play. I think Crowder really knows how to play.
He's a player. Bradley, you know, he has a nice jump shot when he's going well. You know, he's defensively he's tough, but not smart.
And I have to defend my man, Marcus Smart. He's shooting 39.9% from three-point land in the last 12 games. He's got some key rebounds, and he is just one tough guy.
Yeah, he's done some good work on the boards, offensive boards on foul shots. I mean, he uses his, you know, he's a tough player. You know, I don't like him because he can't shoot. You know,
well, I think he can shoot.
Eventually he can because he can't now.
Well, he's shooting almost 40% from three in the last 12 games. So
but you think he's going to stay that way?
Yeah, I think he's working on it. He's a kid. He's practicing.
His
a lot.
Release is not a good release. He's never going to be a consistent shooter. I mean, but he does everything else well.
Well, I never thought Bradley would be the shooter he is.
You know, are they going to change his form a little?
Sure
you watch when he shoots those outside shots, he loses the ball. It's over his head. Well, you're never going to be consistent shooting like that.
I think he's come along as a free throw shooter.
He's a good free throw shooter.
Really tough defender. And I just think he has a lot of moxie.
You know, I hope I'm wrong. I mean, I'd love to see him turn out to be like a Wade-type player. You know, in the lane, pull up jump shots, using his body, physical, you know, hitting those big three-point shots.
I think he has a better chance to be a star player than Bradley does to be an all-star player.
If he can get there, if you're right, I mean, he could be a huge plus for them. I'm just worried that he's going to be inconsistent with his outside shot. And when you have a two-guard who's inconsistent with your outside shot, it hurts him. But you notice, at the end of the game, he's not in there that much. He's in there on defense, and then when they get the ball, they have Turner in there with Bradley and Thomas.
Is there anybody who's untouchable on the Celtics right now?
Well, Isaiah.
Okay. Well, I think that there's two reasons. Number one, he leads the team. But number two, he has a pretty low salary. So if you have all things being relative for the NBA anyway. I mean, they're talking about Horford needing $25 million a year.
That's a tough decision there. But I know who's untouchable also is Crowder. Because you have to have a player like him to be successful. That's why he's untouchable. It's not that he's a star. He's just a very good, solid NBA player. He can do whatever. He does it all. He's a floor player.
Well, another guy who basically was just on the bench in Dallas, and he gets an opportunity here. For the year, he's only 14 a game, but since early in the year, he's closer to 17. So, I mean, he's a really productive guy.
But another guy is smart. Smart becomes a player you think he's going to become, he'll be great for that team.
Right, but a guy like Amir Johnson, if they had something that upgraded. Now, I do not want Dwight Howard. Howard's not the answer.
That's ridiculous. And Michael Hawley says they should get Howard for the season. He's going to disrupt the team.
Howard's not the answer. He's never been the answer.
Horford won't disrupt the team. Teague won't. Those two guys come in, they're playing Cleveland for the Eastern Championship.
Yeah.
If those two guys come in, they're better than anybody else. No one else. Even Toronto. I'm big on Toronto. Some people aren't.
Toronto's guards are phenomenal.
Toronto's really tough. They give the Celtics a tough time. But with Teague and Hoffman on that team, that team all of a sudden becomes a terrific basketball team.
Yeah, I have to agree on that. Now, the Celtics have shot a little bit better from the perimeter, which is so important in today's NBA game. And, you know, they lead the league in shots taken per game. They're right up there in scoring. I think they're third in point differential in the Eastern Conference behind Cleveland and Toronto.
What's going on with their defense, though, Ron, lately?
I don't know.
They were the third best defensive team in the league. Yeah. All of a sudden, teams are scoring in the hundreds against them, probably because of the way they're playing.
Right. Well, you know, I think you have to, you can try to win by holding people defensively, but the game in the NBA nowadays is to just outscore the other team. There's four legitimate contenders for the championship. Golden State, San Antonio, Oklahoma City, and Cleveland. Everybody else is kind of on the outside looking in, even though the Celtics beat Cleveland. That was without Love, and Love's hurt again, I think.
No, Love played in that game.
No, I mean, Love got hurt in the middle of that game.
Okay.
And then he's hurt again. So I don't know how long that's going to be for.
Shoulder, huh?
Yeah, he hurt the shoulder again. So anyway, I mean, Golden State, it's just hard to imagine anybody beating them right now.
San Antonio can beat them. I mean, I know Golden State killed them in that big game a couple of weeks ago, but that's going to be a heck of a series.
There was an interview the other day with Popovich at halftime. So the guy says, "Why are you behind?" He said, "The other team's scored more baskets than we have in the first half." And he says, "Why'd that happen?" He's like, "We played really terrible defense." And then he said, "Do you want to hear any election results?" So Popovich says, "Yeah, sure. Who won?" And he said, and so he gives the results of the primary. And Popovich just walks away shaking his head. He's so funny. They have a really interesting coaching staff. They have Ettore Messina, one of the leading EuroLeague coaches, who's doing his understudy under Popovich, and he'll be an NBA coach. And they have Becky Hammon, the only woman NBA coach, who she might have a team someday too.
What does she work on with them, though?
I don't know.
Was she a guard?
Yeah, she was a guard.
Maybe she works with the guards.
You know, so
she's supposed to be brilliant.
Right.
She did a good job in the summer league team.
Right.
They beat the Celtics.
When you talk about coaching, we like to talk about coaching. There's individual skill development on players. So probably the number one skill guy is Kevin Eastman, who's the development guy with the Clippers. He's been with Rivers forever. Phenomenal teacher. And then there's team development. And, you know, Popovich has had a great offense. A lot of they have a set called Motion Week where they generate a lot of offense by their motion offense. Certainly something that other people have copied, and along with Golden State, they're right up there, almost 40% on three-point shooting. So they've got a lot of European and foreign players who really can shoot the ball.
Yeah, and they know how to play the game. You know, they know how to play the game sometimes better than the
American.
It's like
watching the UConn women.
Watch the UConn women play.
So it's hard to imagine the Celtics being able to compete for a championship this year. But I agree that if they got Horford and Teague or Horford and Korver, they
I don't know about Korver. I wouldn't want him. I would want Teague. Teague can do it all, Teague. He can play defense. He's smart. Real good shooter. Take the ball to the hoop. I mean, he would be unbelievable with Isaiah, with Thomas. And, like, smart and Turner coming in behind
right.
them.
Like, people don't understand Smart, even though he's a guard. He's not a little guard. He's like a linebacker. He's 6'4", 225, 230.
I really hope that, you know, you're right and I'm wrong about him, because, I mean, I look at how tough he is and defensively and how much more superior he is than Bradley. You know, you just watch him out there. He just does so many more things than Bradley does. And Bradley, but in their games, when Bradley just hits that spot-up jump shot, the three-pointer, Bradley wasn't a great shooter.
No, Bradley couldn't hit anything when he came up.
If Smart comes in and he starts hitting that shot, I mean, he can all of a sudden be, to me, I compared him a little to Wade. I mean, Wade isn't as physical as Bradley, but he's physical. He likes to get into that lane and hit those pull-up jump shots. And Bradley would, and Smart would be that type of player. And if he can hit that consistently, hit that three-pointer when he's open, then that's a huge play.
Well, I think that as a team, you need to learn how to win. How do you learn to win? First of all, you have to be able to beat, in my opinion, bad teams at home. Then you've got to be able to beat bad teams on the road. Then when you start to get to the more elite ranks, you can beat good teams in your building. Finally, when you're competing for championships, you can beat good teams on the road. So I think that applies whether you're talking about middle school basketball or high school basketball, and certainly through college and professional teams. The NBA is the highest home winning percentage of any sport. So,
how do the Celtics become better than Toronto? Right now, this team, how do they become better? Because Toronto is better than them right now.
Well, I think Toronto kills them when they bring in the guards, with DeRozan especially.
DeRozan kills them.
So they need to have somebody, I don't know if it's going to be Smart, just assigned to DeRozan if he can stay out of foul trouble.
Yeah, but you're never going to shut him down. But how do you get better? You think the Celtics can get, with the team they have now, like players like Smart can keep getting better? But, you know, I really believe Bradley brings him down. I don't care when he has his great shooting games. He's just not a smart player.
Well, probably the best thing they can hope for is that Howard winds up in Toronto, because he'll mess them up.
Well, I like making that deal. I mean, I have to think that Ainge is thinking that. If he's involved with Atlanta, if they ever can make that, if they make that deal we talked about, then Neil will be a better team than Toronto. Now you got to work to become better than Cleveland. You know, and that's, you know how you get better than Cleveland? In the next couple of years, when LeBron James gets a couple of years older and can't dominate, you're seeing it now. He's still great. He's still the best player. He is the best player in the NBA.
Well, the guy that kills him on Cleveland, and you know
I
that,
know,
is
yeah,
Thompson. He gets the stupid offensive rebounds down the end.
Well, that's what one player in the Celtics talked about that. They said, we were playing great defense last year, but they get the rebound when they played him in the playoffs. But I really think that you could see in the next 2 years the Celtics are the number one team in the East. Just think about it, because, again, LeBron's getting older and older. I mean, he's not going to be able to go out in there and just dominate a game in a couple of years. He's still going to be one of the top.
Well, San Antonio is really old, so they don't have too much time left.
Duncan, I'm talking about the East.
Yeah.
Though.
Well, I know, but you have to be able to ultimately be able to compete in the West.
Yeah.
And then the word is that what's his name? Durant is interested in playing for Golden State. That's all they need.
Well, if that happens, forget about it. They'll win it for the next 5 years.
Yeah, you know, with Curry, Green, Thompson, Durant, no way they can stop
Barnes
that.
Barnes coming off the bench. But, you know, I'm really, you know what gets me? When we talked about it during one of our shows. The thing that gets me is people saying, oh, you know, the Celtics is going to be years before they win another championship, this and that. Enjoy the team. You know, I wasn't enjoying them. After that show, they weren't playing good ball, and it wasn't fun watching them. I mean, they just were disorganized. But lately, the last 15 games, they've been playing terrific basketball. Enjoy it. Watch them rebuild. I mean, of course they're not going to win in the next 2 years. They make that trade and get a couple of players in that want to play under Stevens. You know, all of a sudden, they're the number one team in the East.
Well, that's the thing. We haven't mentioned Stevens, and he's certainly in the top five coaches in the league already. As far as being able to mesh this, you know, I don't think anybody would say the Celtics' talent is in the top half of the league, but certainly they're probably in the top 10 teams in the league now. So,
yeah, I mean, their guards, their guards can compete against a lot of the team's guards. Well, they go with the three-guard offense.
Right.
Sometimes Crowder's the power forward like he was yesterday.
Right.
You know, Sullinger's been playing pretty good at times.
Well, small ball is the rage right now in the NBA, which is why the devaluation of the seven-footer. I mean, Zeller's done a really good job the last half dozen games when he's gotten a chance.
But no, another thing, too, is Michael Felger saying, you know, hey, enough's enough with Ainge. It's about time Ainge does something. You know, what has he done? They had a championship team. They almost won another one, again, when the Lakers beat him in the seventh game. He makes that trade. He's got Isaiah Thomas. He brings in Crowder. Now they're competitive. They're 9 games over .500. And it's starting to take off a little. You know, one good move, if he makes another good move.
You have two factors. You have the salary cap, and you have the weather. When there's basketball in Phoenix and Florida and Texas and everything else, there's a lot of players who want to be in warm weather destinations. And it's hard to get it to say that have the coach be a major drawing card. Well, I mean, we'll see.
Yeah, but you ask Isaiah Thomas, what team do you want to play for? Celtics. I want to stay with the Celtics. I love it here. Crowder, who would you want to play for? I want to play for the Celtics. I love it here. I mean, they're making the money now, and they're getting the time. You know, Jarepko says, I've never been with a group like this. You know, he's played in two other teams.
Well, it's so you know, for a coach, Chuck Daly, Hall of Famer, coached the Pistons to two NBA championships, coached the Dream Team, said, number one, I'm a salesman. You have to sell the organization, and you have to treat the players the right way. So they have to buy in and want to be part of your program. I don't know, did you hear Maxwell talking to Mahorn? He's talking during a broadcast.
Oh, no.
Mahorn, I guess, said something about a foul, and Maxwell said, like, that was nothing. You used to foul everybody worse than that. He said, come down here and say that. And this is the middle of the game. And then Sean Grandy says, like, Max, you know, you're on the air there. He said, like, oh, that wasn't supposed to be for public consumption. So funny. We'll be right back. Just in closing about basketball, Ralph wanted to talk a little bit about our philosophy. And my philosophy in girls basketball has totally evolved and changed from what I thought. I just believe is you should try to bludgeon the team with offense so that you should try to score as many points as you can and make the other team score up to your level. And now, I don't have size, so I've gone to a full court, full-time press, and then fast break at every opportunity. The only part of the game that we don't have is we don't have three-point shooting. And I certainly haven't had the toughest schedule, but we've played a number of first division teams and A teams, and right now we're 18-1 with that beat them on offense philosophy. So I'm sticking with it.
I don't know what my philosophy is anymore. No, we're having a season. It's a tough season. I put my team in the toughest leagues in the state. It's funny. We're having a tough time. We have been competitive. I mean, I look at it different than a lot of people, players, parents, other coaches. I look at it as we can compete against the best teams, and that's what I want at the end of the year, to know that we did that. And we've had some good teams against some good games against real good teams. Walpole, which was in the top, one of the top two teams last year, we lost them by 12 at Walpole in a pretty good game. And Franklin, one of the top teams, 7. Last night we played Bill Ricker, and they're a very good River Valley A team. They're the number two team in that league, and we lost by 14. But to me, it was competitive. We played terrific defense in the first half. That's what I'm looking at now. I'm not looking at wins and loss. I'm looking at how we're competing. And in the first half, we competed great. Couldn't hit a shot. Couldn't hit a shot. If we hit a few shots, it would have been a great game. You know, we had a tough time offensively. But, you know, the girls, like at the end of the game yesterday, I told them, I said, the first half, you gave everything you had. The second half, you started to wilt as the game went on. But you were still competitive, I thought,
right,
from what I'm looking at. So that,
right,
my philosophy,
right,
is.
Our signature win, we went over to Arlington last year, and Arlington beat us by over 30 points, totally dominated. We didn't look like we belonged in the same gym with them. Now, we weren't really prepared for what they were going to do. Be that as it may, we had some inexperienced players. We have a different group. But we went over there last weekend and beat them by 2 at the buzzer. So to go from a total wipeout to be able to beat a middle-of-the-road Metro West team in their gym, I thought was really good progress for our kids. So I think I give them all the credit. They've worked really hard, really competitive group. A couple of the parents had told me their daughters are a little intimidated being on this team because the kids are so competitive. But, you know, that's what you want to see. You want to see kids, yeah, battling every day of practice and playing hard. And because, you know, that translates, they're going to be studying hard, they're going to be competing hard, they're going to do well in the future off the court as well.
But, you know, another thing, too, is like what people don't realize, I was looking at our games, the tournaments, and we've played some teams in the B League. We're 11-1 in the 12 games we've played outside those two leagues. You know, and then you're playing in those leagues, and I was telling you before the show, we went up against a tremendous defensive team yesterday, and it's just going to, they're not going to see anything like it in high school. Maybe one or two teams in high school. I mean, when you compare that to when they're in high school.
Right. The there's no way to get legitimate rankings in high school. You get opinions based on what people have seen and their biases for and against certain leagues. MaxPreps.com ranks the teams based on head-to-head competition, strength of schedule, and wins. So the top team in the Middlesex League, Woburn, is ranked number 54 in Massachusetts in MaxPreps.
How do they rate it number 5 in the state?
I don't know.
In the globe.
That's what
because they're not the fifth best team in the state. That's for sure.
Well, you know, certainly on the South Shore, Braintree is a terrific team every year, one of the top few teams. AC is up there in the top 20. I think they're probably stronger than Woburn. And you have the teams like Franklin and Foxborough who are really strong. Oliver Ames is really strong.
You know, looking at them, I only saw the Woburn game. I'm going to go to Stoneham game tomorrow night. I want to see the girls play Stoneham at home tomorrow at 5. But I saw the Woburn game. Woburn's good. They're good. But they're a good high school basketball team. They're not a great high school basketball team. They're not one of the best teams in the state, and they're undefeated. You know, and I mean, they just beat Reading the other day. They just beat Melrose at Melrose. I saw that game. And Melrose is coming on stronger. They're playing a lot better basketball now. I mean, the girls are playing with more confidence. And I think even next year, they'll battle for the champs, for the league championship. Next year, it's going to be, I think, Watertown and Melrose are the top two teams.
Right. Well, Watertown has Shannon Murphy, and that she's about a 6'1", 6'2", center who makes it difficult to score inside. She's got a scholarship to Holy Cross. And, you know, you have to make, if you have a player like that, you have to get him in foul trouble or you have to be able to shoot from outside.
Well, our girls, when we had them, beat her team 12 out of 13 times in the 3 years we played them. Girls knew how to defend her.
Right.
And, I mean, that's what you had. You had this junior class beat her. She's a junior, beat them, again, 12 out of 13 times.
Right, and they played Woburn probably 50-50 during the time they played them.
In the Woburn game, I was a little, I thought Merrill's could have won that game. They played them good. At the end, they were playing real. Cat had a great second half, great fourth quarter. Blocked about 6 shots in the fourth quarter alone against Woburn. So, you know, I want to see them, you know, this year they're coming on strong. Hopefully they'll do something in the tournament.
Well, 3 more games against middle of the road teams. Yeah, they should beat all 3 teams pretty easily.
They'll go 13-7 and they'll hopefully get a home game.
Yeah, I would think so.
You know, maybe, you know, it'd be nice to see them win at least 2 games in the tournament. They have the chance. I mean, Alexis Doherty's tremendous as a sophomore. Caroline Nolan is playing great with her, so the backcourt of those two. Cat's playing a lot better up front. We know Lenora Ivers, and a couple of the other seniors, Smith, and who's the other one?
Bornstein.
And is it Foley?
Foley.
Foley's a solid player. So, you know, Foot, senior, they're going to lose those.
She was injured a lot.
Yeah. But, I mean, they're coming on strong, and, you know, again, they're getting the confidence. I talked to a couple of them yesterday. They feel really good about the team. So, who knows? That team, we said it, that group, they were going to be battling for the league championship, and they were going to become one of the top teams in the state. Let's see if that happens next year. There's a good chance there, especially with a couple of the freshmen on the team, and Doherty is going to be even better next year with the next year's senior class.
Well, you know, so many different things can happen in sports. You can, for whatever reason, people, you know, advance much faster than you think, or sometimes they transfer, they get injuries. A million things can happen, so you never really know. Well, the Red Sox are starting spring training, pitchers and catchers, next week. I think that they've improved their bullpen a lot, especially with Kimbrell, and that will reassign roles. I'm still not really sold on the starting rotation because beyond Price, I think they still have question marks. Purcello's not great. Rodriguez is an unproven young player. Buchholz, you never know what you're going to get, but it's not going to be a lot of innings.
But you know, Ron, they could be real good, and they could be okay. I mean, if Buchholz stays healthy, Kelly pitches like he did at the end of the year, you know, and a couple of those other pitches, the bullpen's going to be strong. you know, I think they're the team they field on the field, they're not as strong as people think.
Well,
what
you see is the copycat schedule approach, where because Kansas City went to the World Series 2 years in a row, it's about building your bullpen, trying to get to the bullpen in the sixth, seventh inning with a close game, and then just winning with the bullpen. Whether the Red Sox and the Yankees can duplicate that, we'll see.
Well, the Yankees sure, definitely, because they had it last year. I mean, with the bullpen, they just need. They need Teixeira to stay healthy. He's going to be the key.
Well, and they need Ellsbury to
play
be to
and
be
Gardner.
Yeah,
Ellsbury and Gardner have to play. They have to have good seasons.
I mean, Ellsbury was hitting 324 when he got hurt, but then he only hit 224 the rest of the year, and he
Gardner
really hasn't.
Too.
Yeah.
And then they lost Teixeira, but they have Castro at second base now, steady second baseman who can hit the ball. So you got him in there at second. Last year they were very weak at second. You know, so that infield is going to be strong. Teixeira is the key.
Well, Bird's out for the year.
Yeah, so that's why Teixeira is huge. But look at their bullpen. They get to the sixth inning.
Oh, yeah.
They get to the sixth inning. If they stay healthy, I mean, and their pitching staff's not bad if they
stay. Well, they have Miller, they have Chapman, and
Betances,
who's fantastic. Who has been fantastic throughout his whole career.
Yeah, but they need Tanaka to stay healthy, Pineda to stay healthy. Osvaldo's back. You know, he got hurt. Don't forget, he got hurt the second half of the year when he was like 14-2.
And your favorite?
Severino?
Sabathia. Oh.
You don't want me to say. Hopefully he gives him what a fourth or fifth starter would give.
Well,
him.
Hopefully he's overcome his substance problems. And
yeah, he's only making $25 million a year. You think he couldn't stay straight?
Well, you know, speaking of that, I know you've been a big Johnny Manziel guy. What's your latest on Johnny?
Well, I was big because I knew how talented he was, but I mean, this guy's really self-destructing big time. But, you know, coming out of college, I loved him as a quarterback, but I didn't know he was this crazy.
Well, what is shocking is that in the wake of his departure, two quarterbacks from A&M are transferring because they said the whole environment at Texas A&M is toxic because the culture of Manziel stayed, even though Manziel left.
Wow.
So, which I thought their coach, a guy named Sumlin, was a pretty mature leader, but that you're still coaching college kids, and apparently it's Animal House there.
You look at the Patriots with Brady all these years, huh? How lucky we've been.
Well, the Patriots have some choices to make. Chandler Jones, for example. Yeah, you got to think.
Get rid of him.
He's on the short leash. They had Stephen Guskowski was featured the other day in a Boston.com spread. He was visiting patients in the hospital, one of whom happens to be a Stoneham resident. So it was really interesting to see him doing some good work and talking about that.
Did you talk about his point after? The guy asked him any questions. I heard he had 103 degree temperature the night before.
Really?
I heard he was very sick going into the game. But he kicked the field goal. He kicked the ball through the end zone a couple of times. So, but they said he had a high temperature the night before.
Oh.
I don't know if that had it. I don't think it would have hurt.
You know, people miss.
Didn't he have 400 and something in a row?
500 and something. Anyway. But then obviously settling up with Jamie Collins is.
Collins and Hightower to Keys.
And you
got to Jones.
Mayo is probably gone.
Yeah.
Unless they make him an assistant coach. There's been some talk about that because his health is failing. And, you know, at some point along the way, Malcolm Butler and, believe it or not, Logan Ryan are going to get paid. Well, Ryan had a pretty good year.
So. Yeah, he'll get some pretty good money. And I like Coleman. Coleman's going to be another Butler, I think.
Yeah, people have said he's made a lot of progress.
He was a free agent last year, and, you know, I watch him on defense. He's always with the receiver. May get beat up, you know, at times, but he's always on the receiver. And it reminded me of Butler when I saw Butler last year earlier on. So, you know, if Coleman becomes that, two free agents.
Well, you know, it's really important that he easily get healthy and productive. He
up the middle, that hurt him.
Yeah, he showed something when he was healthy, and especially when you pair him with Brown, who's more of a bull.
And I like to see Branch back.
Yeah.
And that guy he picked up that had, was it Ellis? What was his name?
Oh, the Akeem Hicks.
Hicks. I like to see him stay with the team. He did, you know, he was strong.
I think he's a free agent, though, so I don't know if they're going to be able to
But, you know, who's going to give him big money? You know, they may be able to sign him. But, you know, Hightower and Collins are the two keys.
And then there's a lot of talk that Dante Scarnecchia is going to come back as the offensive line coach. And apparently he had a lot of success with Cannon, who really hasn't had much success since he's been gone. So he really likes Cannon. And
I think the best thing for Cannon is they cut him. I mean, he is absolutely horrible. And Fleming's not too far behind them. Well, Fleming and Cannon can't move.
Yeah,
although Palmer didn't move much either against Weir.
They'll have Solder back.
Maybe Wendell.
And, you know,
Klein.
So much of what happens to you in the NFL is dependent on injuries. You know, and if you have a good year keeping your players healthy, then you have a chance. And if you don't.
Yeah, I mean, you have Solder, Palmer, Stark at center. All right, you're solid there with those three.
Right.
You hope Klein played great 2 years ago when he won the Super Bowl. His ratings were very high, especially against Baltimore. And then Mason or Jackson, they'll be their second year. You know, but Cannon, they got to get rid of him. I mean, the guy is useless. He can't move, Ron.
Well, he had hurt his toe. I don't know.
The guy's going around him, and I think I can move faster than him. He's trying to move to his left, and the guy's already by him.
You just never know how much people are hurt. You know, just because a guy's out there doesn't mean he's healthy.
Is he hurt all season?
Probably.
But I think Mason and Mason especially with Klein, God.
And then they still need a bigger receiver who's productive. I think LaFell.
They need a receiver and get downfield.
LaFell is probably gone.
He's gone.
And then they need a replacement running back. Blunt will be gone. Who knows if the kid Lewis will be back.
Lewis, hopefully he's healthy next year. That was a huge loss, too.
But his track record is he can't stay healthy.
It's a shame, because if that team stayed healthy, you know, they would have probably won the Super Bowl again. But, it's, you know, it's all luck.
Yeah. No, I mean, for Denver, Osweiler stepped in and was able to be productive while Manning was out. And then their defense was phenomenal.
Yeah, and if they were playing at, you know, Foxborough that game, which it should have been, the Pats can blame themselves. More than the Denver loss, blame themselves for losing those games against Denver and Philadelphia and the Miami game where they didn't come to play. Brady should have never played in that game. If he was going to come in with that thinking, Belichick, he should have had Brady sit out that game and just attack Miami the whole game.
Well, it gets
worried about,
you know, we make the presumption that there's not going to be any drop-off in Brady's performance every season, but he is getting older, and, you know, at any time, he could just start to lose it.
I know. I mean, you hope that he's got three more years. You know, that's what I'm hoping for. If he has three more years, they could win two more Super Bowls. I think six looks good, right?
Yeah.
I mean, why can't they? I mean, with the team they have, the talent they have.
Well, certainly they're much more balanced than they were for the few years when they were in having a drought. And especially, you know, you still have to be able to beat Denver, because Denver is going to remain a strong team. And you have to be able, I think.
If they sign Miller.
I think Baltimore will be back. I don't know what happened to him this year. So the Jets look like they're on the rise. You know, if they keep Fitzpatrick, I don't know if that's good or bad for them.
But the Pats' defense is going to get stronger and stronger. They're going to be really good. The offense has to stay healthy. Hopefully Lewis is healthy all next year. Edelman stays healthy. Amendola, you know, Gronk and Brady, and that offensive line. But then that's a lot of ifs, because every team has injuries. But if they stay healthy, they win it. It's that simple. If they're healthy, if they have good fortune.
Well, they go off at 8-1 in Vegas as the co-favorites, along with, I think, Seattle and Pittsburgh.
But Noah was sad in that Denver game run. I'm thinking back to the year before when Brady was getting time to throw the ball, and he was eating alive of those teams, Baltimore and, you know, Indianapolis.
Well, I think they made
Seattle.
They made the assumption that they didn't need very much blocking because Brady was going to release the ball so quickly. And Denver counteracted it with their schemes, so that plan didn't work out. And they had exceptional rush, too.
But, Ron, second half, I think it was 16 for 32. I'm pretty sure it was. 16 for 32, 200-something yards.
Well, we'll have to check that out.
Yeah.
I've enjoyed being with you tonight. I'm Ron Sen.
And I'm Ralph LaBella, and thank you for watching Let's Talk Sports.